Thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. I am Muriel Bowser. I'm the mayor of Washington, D.C. We're located in the Walter Washington Convention Center. I'm here to provide an update on preparations for the 59th presidential inauguration, which by now everyone knows has an unprecedented level of preparation and execution. I am joined by members of my administration as well as our federal partners. Let me start by introducing Matt Miller, who is the special agent in charge of the Washington Field Office of the United States Secret Service. The United States Secret Service is, of course, the lead agency for national special security events, including the 59th inauguration. Marianne Tierney, who's the regional administrator for the Federal Emergency Management Agency. We'll hear from Ms. Tierney, but she will have to depart following her remarks. Jeff Reinbold, superintendent of the National Mall and Memorial Parks for the National Park Service. Stephen Booker, who is the acting assistant chief for the United States Park Police. Paul Wiedefeld, who is the general manager and CEO for the Washington Metropolitan Area Transit Authority, or Metro. Ronald Pavlik, the chief of the Metro Transit Police. Also, Chief Conti of the Metropolitan Police Department, or DC Police, Kevin Donahue, who is the city administrator for the District of Columbia, as well as Chief Donnelly, who is the chief of the DC Fire and Emergency in the Emergency Medical Service. We may be also joined by representatives of the DC National Guard, who we have invited to join us as well. Let me start with a brief situational update, and we will then hear from our guest. I want to reiterate my request to Americans to enjoy this 59th inauguration of the President of the United States and the Vice President of the United States from home. Enjoy it virtually on January 20th. Our tradition, in fact, our constitutional mandate that the transition of power occurs by noon on January the 20th will happen right here in the District of Columbia. And we want everybody to enjoy it and enjoy it right in their own states, in their own living rooms, and with their own families. We know that this is the right request for our public safety and our public health. The National Park Service is, of course, the steward of our nation's parks, including parks right here in Washington, D.C. And while the situation continues to change each day, we do know that as of this morning, various road closures are in effect and garages in the district have been restricted as well. If you've tried to drive around the city, you already know this. There is a recent posting of streets that have been impacted by these closures. And here is the most recent list of road closures released this morning by the National Park Service in cooperation with the United States Secret Service. We continue to ask anyone who doesn't absolutely need to be out and about or in those restricted areas to avoid them. Earlier this week, Metro announced service adjustments that went into effect today and will be in place through Thursday, January 21st. And that includes 13 Metro stations and detouring 26 Metro bus routes. You can learn more about those adjustments at WMATA.com. Additionally, streetcar service in the district is suspended. And you can continue to find updates on that at inauguration.dc.gov. We also know that residents are eager to do what they can do to keep our city safe. and we certainly appreciate it. So we want you to be vigilant, look around yourselves when you're out and about, and if you see something, absolutely say something. And you may report anything that you think is out of the norm by calling 911. You may report suspicious activity at 727-9099. You can go to MPD's iWatchDC.org website or text TIPS to 50411. We are also recommending that businesses download, print, and display these signs. And these signs let anyone know that firearms are not welcome on the premises. We want businesses who encounter anyone with a weapon to call 911 and try not to confront that person or persons themselves. These signs can be downloaded at inauguration.dc.gov. Later today, HSEMA, that's DC's Homeland Security Agency, and MPD will host a community call to discuss the district's planning. Residents and stakeholders can join that call today at 4:30 p.m. by dialing 844-881-1314. The conversation will also be broadcast live on Channel 16, as well as all DC government platforms. If you haven't already done so, sign up to receive specific alerts by registering. You can register and text INAUG2021 to 888-777. And finally, all of this information can be located in one place at inauguration.dc.gov. Once again, we will hear from our partners who have been engaged in this planning and are responsible for various aspects of execution. First and foremost, Matt Miller is the special agent in charge of the Washington Field Office for the United States Secret Service. Mr. Miller. Agent Miller, I should say.
Mr. Miller works. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you, Mayor Bowser, for inviting me to join you. And on behalf of the men and women of the United States Secret Service, I'm happy to speak about plans for next week's presidential inauguration and answer any questions that may arise at this time. January 20th will be this nation's 59th presidential inauguration. Designated as a National Special Security Event, or NSSE, the Secret Service is again serving as the lead agency with respect to operational planning and security for the event. As most of you are aware, the Department of Homeland Security recently extended the NSSE designation dates for the period covering January 13th to January 21st in response to the events of January 6th, when an election protest turned into a violent, deadly, and unlawful assault on the United States Capitol. For well over a year, we have been working with our federal, state, and municipal partners to develop and implement a comprehensive operational security plan to ensure the safety of everyone participating in the event, as well as those who may try to come to DC to watch the inauguration or spend time in the nation's capital. Anyone who's seen any of the mayor's recent press conferences or listened to her earlier statements will realize we're discouraging this in lieu of virtual participation, but we are prepared. We cannot allow a recurrence of the chaos and illegal activity that the United States and the world witnessed last week. Our democracy is built on the rule of law, and the Secret Service workforce is dedicated and committed to uphold its oath to the Constitution and assure that its vital, no-fail mission regarding the security of the presidential inauguration and the peaceful transfer of power is carried out. This year, of course, as everyone is aware, our country is battling the most significant health crisis to face the nation in more than a century. And the need to follow recommended public health guidance, combined with the increased measures resulting from last week's events, will undoubtedly impact the inauguration in almost every aspect. That said, our security plan was developed to respond to any contingency that might arise on and leading up to January 20th. Our partners for securing the inauguration include, among many, many others, the Federal Emergency Management Agency, which is responsible for incident response and recovery, the Federal Bureau of Investigations, which is responsible for intelligence and incident investigation, and of course, the men and women of the Metropolitan Police Department. As for any NSSE, the Secret Service's core strategy is to leverage our existing outstanding partnerships with our local law enforcement, public safety, and military colleagues here in the National Capital Region, as well as those who are directly here in support of the week's events, and to collaboratively develop a comprehensive security plan for the inauguration. As you would expect, there are many partners involved in this planning, a number of whom are here behind me. The Secret Service employs a unified command model. We establish an executive steering committee, which is staffed with senior representatives from these agencies and others, who have primary jurisdiction over various aspects of the inauguration, and then create subcommittees, in this particular instance, 28, dedicated to everything from crowd management, credentialing, maritime security, access control, medical care, just to name a few. The expertise and coordination of everyone involved is critical to a successful event. We have conducted numerous training initiatives, tabletop exercises, rehearsals, field and senior command level exercises to ensure we have immediate, well-coordinated, and effective response to any of the challenges we might face during this inauguration. Using this process, we've developed a comprehensive, integrated, and while it may not look like it from the outside, nimble security plan to ensure a safe environment for our protectees, the event, and the general public. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Agent Miller. Administrator Tierney.
Thank you. Thank you, Mayor Bowser. I am Marianne Tierney. I am the Regional Administrator for the Federal Emergency Management Agency. While FEMA is not a law enforcement agency, public safety is our number one priority for the inauguration. FEMA has taken several actions to promote good public safety during this event. The President has declared an emergency that has enabled FEMA to do several things. The first thing is we have deployed a national incident management team to the DC Emergency Operations Center to work in support of our district partners. We have also deployed regional incident management assistance teams to both Maryland and Virginia to support their planning and actions. We have been working with the district to identify resource requirements. For example, we are currently working a mission to pre-stage ambulance resources, and also we have moved commodities such as food, water, and shelter supplies closer in to support the district should that be needed. We continue to support the Secret Service in their efforts to plan for this event. FEMA has also conducted several exercises in response to requests from the Secret Service as well as other agencies to help prepare since January 6th. That is all I have, pending any questions.
Let me now introduce Jeff Reinbold, who is the superintendent for the National Mall Memorial Parks from the National Park Service.
Thank you, Mayor Bowser. Good afternoon. Inaugurations are special times, right, for our nation, for our city, and especially for those of us at the National Mall who host a lot of the events around an inauguration. This one is no doubt very challenging. And we've had a chance to work with the Presidential Inaugural Committee since November to come up with a reimagined inauguration. We did receive a letter from the U.S. Secret Service yesterday asking us to consider closing several areas within the National Mall. This is essentially the monumental core, the area around the White House and sections of Pennsylvania Avenue. I do want to thank the Secret Service, the U.S. Park Police, for working with us to understand what their concerns are, how we could help address this national security issue, to make sure that the icons that we administer are protected, and also to make sure that, if possible, we could allow for First Amendment activities in the park. We are the premier First Amendment area in the country, in the world probably, and we wanted to see if it was possible to do that and also meet their security needs. So as of this morning, the Secretary of the Interior has officially closed the areas in the National Mall. That includes, again, the core area and the locations that the mayor mentioned before, in support of the request from the Secret Service and the U.S. Park Police. I do want to talk for just a second about the First Amendment areas. We were able to identify two locations. We had several groups that had submitted First Amendment applications, and we were able to identify two locations on Pennsylvania Avenue where up to 100 people will be able to gather. They will be met by U.S. Park Police, escorted through magnetometers, and then taken to these areas so that they can exercise their First Amendment rights. I do again want to thank the Park Police and the Secret Service for trying to find a way that we could accommodate that, but recognize that these are different times and require different measures. I also want to acknowledge Mayor Bowser for working with the Secretary of the Interior to address some of the concerns that she has for the city. Thank you.
Thank you, Superintendent. Stephen Booker, the Acting Assistant Chief for the United States Park Police.
Thank you, Mayor Bowser. On behalf of Acting Chief Monahan and the United States Park Police, the men and women, as Agent Matt Miller said, this is unprecedented. This inauguration is something filled with excitement, hope, and hopefully a new path forward. The United States Park Police, as stewards of democracy, ensure that First Amendment rights are allowed to occur on federal park lands, and our officers do it with emotional and personal fortitude to make sure that the mission of the National Park Service and Department of Interior is intact. Our roles are not only the law enforcement arm of the National Park Service within Washington, D.C., but also San Francisco and in New York as well. We are here to stand by the NSSE and all of our D.C. officials, our public safety administrators, our local law enforcement to ensure a safe and secure event next week. We work collaboratively, and we have been doing so for months now in our incident management team, with many men and women engulfed long hours into this planning. I congratulate them, a few more days left, to ensure we have a safe event for next week. I'm here afterwards for any additional questions that you may have. Thank you.
Thank you. Paul Wiedefeld, General Manager for Metro WMATA.
Thank you, Mayor Bowser, for your leadership during this inaugural, but more importantly, for your leadership through this turbulent year and your support for Metro. Thank you so much. I also want to give a special thanks to our frontline employees. These are the bus operators, the train operators, the station managers, and our police who have once again shown their commitment to this region during this difficult time and this difficult year. Working with Chief Conte and U.S. Secret Service, we basically have ensured that we have safety for our employees and for our customers, but at the same time, providing service for those that still need it outside of the security area. What the customers will see is a stepped-up transit police presence. We also have reached out to our brethren, basically, at other transit agencies, and you will see police officers from Baltimore, New York, New Jersey, Chicago, New Orleans, Houston, Denver, and San Francisco also in our system throughout this week. As the mayor mentioned, there are 11 rail stations already closed today and two more tomorrow, and 26 bus lines will be impacted. Again, the best information for that is on our website, WMATA.com. These closures and diversions will stay in effect until through Thursday the 21st. In closing, I know this is inconvenient for our customers and for a lot of the businesses in the region, but it's necessary for their safety as well. So thank you again, Mayor, for your leadership on this.
And I want to introduce now the lead law enforcement agency for the district, of course, and Chief Robert Conti to speak for MPD. And we will be available for questions, members of my entire team who are standing to my left. Chief Conti.
Every 4 years, our nation celebrates and honors the continuation and peaceful transition of presidential executive powers. For over 1.5 centuries, people have come from all over the world to witness and commemorate this historic event. However, this year will be significantly different. As we have done since President Lincoln's second inaugural ceremony in 1865, the Metropolitan Police Department members, along with our many partners, have had the greatest honor participating in the planning and execution of the presidential inauguration. We know that every MPD member who has had the opportunity to participate in an inaugural event has looked back on the unique experiences for the rest of their lives. And since the 1890s, members of the outside law enforcement agencies from across the nation have provided vital support to MPD in the inaugural proceedings and will do so again this year. While things are different this year due to the ongoing public health emergency and the insurrection that took place at the Capitol last week, it rests upon the dedicated law enforcement officers to provide the utmost in safety, security, and professional police service to all those who come to take part in this momentous occasion. The expertise of each participating law enforcement, public safety, and military agency is critical to the success of a coordinated and executed security plan. The Metropolitan Police Department has carefully planned for resources and personnel for this event, and the additional resources will enable MPD to provide the same great level of quality and professional police service to our communities. All of our officers will be on hand to participate in ensuring a peaceful day, both for inaugural events and throughout our great city. MPD continually collaborates with our federal partners and monitors various intelligence sources for information regarding possible threats to DC. At this time, I really would just like to echo the comments of our mayor for people to really enjoy this as a virtual event. We are working hard not only to secure the event itself, but also working very hard to reassure the communities of the District of Columbia that we are prepared for this event. Thank you.
Okay, with that, we'll take some questions, and I think Susanna is going to help us get people acknowledged, and if you could just state your name and your organization.
Sure, yes. This is Michael Bryce Sadler with the Washington Post. My first question is, for the people who live and work downtown in the district, what's the protocol for them if they need to access areas that are currently fenced off?
Okay, thanks for that question. Michael's asking, how does a resident access the secured areas? And I'm going to ask the Secret Service to address that question.
Thank you, ma'am. Michael, first I'd like to say, I went to college and grad school in the city. 66% of our agency works in the city. There isn't a man or woman in the Secret Service who is not keenly aware of just how much of an impact our security measures have. And please believe me when I say we do everything we can to mitigate and lessen the necessary security measures to safeguard an event like this. For everyone inside what we call the green line or the red line, the outer secure perimeter, we have divided that up into 12 zones. We have an agent who over the last 7 months has been reaching out to all the property managers, all the businesses, and all the federal buildings, office buildings, et cetera, to coordinate what people will need to get in and out on foot or when parking garages will be closed down and when they'll need to walk out in order to get transportation from there. My first recommendation, if there is any confusion, would be to talk to the property manager, the front office staff, to find out what they were told. And if there is still further confusion, to make sure they find who that Secret Service agent is. And again, the building, the security, the management will know who that individual is to find out. And if there are special accommodations which need to be made, we also have the ability to do that. We've worked very, very closely with the U.S. Attorney's offices, the courts, law enforcement, who are working these criminal investigations pursuant to last week to make sure they can go on without interruption. We've had to do that with other businesses as well. But we have been engaging in outreach with all of our partners, both residential, commercial, and governmental, to make sure that they can access their residences, their businesses, or their places of work.
To that, follow-up to that, where will media be permitted on the day of the inauguration?
That I would have to defer to the communications subcommittee. They've been coordinating with all the various media partners and outlets to make sure that they are credentialed and that they have access. I don't know specifically right now, but we can get that answer back to you.
Okay, thank you.
Yes.
Hi, Jane Recker, Washingtonian. Last time we saw some trouble with hotels where they were overrun by people without masks who were potentially violent. They didn't know how to handle it. I know that Airbnb has promised that it's not going to be renting out properties during the coming weeks. What guidance have you given to hotels? Are hotels going to be shutting down? And if not, what kind of support are you going to be offering them to help them manage whoever might be coming in?
So I think we addressed this question earlier in the week, and I think it should be pretty clear that we have some housing needs still in the city. So we have not ordered hotels to shut down in the Central Business District or in the district. However, we do know that they know their business operations the best, and they may make a decision not to offer services for public safety reasons or other reasons during this period of time. We have been in close contact with the hotel associations and various property managers, and we will continue to do that, and they can continue to call on MPD for other help.
And then my next question is, with so much being blocked off downtown, so much enforcement there, I think people are thinking, okay, if these people can't get downtown, where do they go next? What is the threat level? How concerned should people be who live in neighborhoods near the downtown area or who live in historically black neighborhoods across the city?
Let me first ask the United States Secret Service to talk in general about how they're preparing for security, and MPD and HCMA to add to that.
Thank you, Mayor. As far as the current threat situation, I don't think anybody is unaware of Director Ray's testimony or the FBI's releases on the proliferation of, for lack of a better term, chatter around the country. All 50 state FBI JTTFs in the four territories are working 24 hours a day to pursue every lead, every credible threat, and run that to ground. It is truly a whole-of-government approach. As far as specifics for security for this inauguration, we do recognize that because we have such a robust and hardened perimeter, we have so many assets inside the Penn Quarter Capitol area, that there is the potential for people to go elsewhere, whether it's back to their state capitals or to other parts of the city. MPD serves this city exceptionally well. We have had very candid conversations about we can't create a fortress and allow the rest of the city to suffer in services, whether it's fire EMS or public safety. There is a very, very good plan led by Chief Conte, Assistant Chief Carroll, Commander Glover. The city should not be concerned that they will be let down by MPDC. There's also a plan with the Bureau, with the National Guard Bureau, and with all the representatives here in the city that should there be intelligence directing threats to other state capitals, they can respond in a timely and appropriate fashion. Does that answer your question?
I believe so. Thank you.
I'm Sam Ford with Channel 7. I had a question for Director Reinbolt, talking about the protests that will be allowed. I'd like just to know more about this in this case. You said there were two protests or two locations. I'm not quite clear on that. And people will be checked to go. Could you tell us a little more about that?
Sure. We had two requests for First Amendment activities. And so we had numerous requests, including from the city, to cancel all permitted activities within the park. And I'm happy to say that most of the people that had special events, whether they be weddings or celebrations on MLK Day, worked with us to find different locations, different places. The two First Amendment permits that we received, the requests, we were able to work with them, identify a size of the group that the park police were able to look at specific locations and figure out how many they thought could fit in those areas and meet COVID requirements and still safety requirements. We've done this in the past before, but we'll have escorted folks in often at inaugurations. And so this would be an opportunity where those groups can come, those folks can come. They'll be screened through magnetometers. They'll be with U.S. Park Police the entire time to their locations, and then they'll have the ability to express their First Amendment rights.
And what are the locations and who are the groups?
I don't have the groups off the top of my head, but the locations are at the Navy Memorial and then also at John Marshall Park.
Thank you, Mark Seagraves, NBC Washington. For the mayor and for the Secret Service, first for the mayor or MPD, what can you tell us about the use of curfews, car searches, roadblocks, bridge closures? We already saw one bridge today closed, at least temporarily. What's being planned as far as that, that you can give us any kind of indication what we might see in the coming days?
Sure. So, Mark, we put up on our first slide, and we can go back to it, the road closures that are in place as of this morning. I will ask residents to stay alerted by signing up for one of our alerts because that's subject to change. I am aware that the United States Secret Service is considering some other closures inbound to Washington, and I think they will announce those when those decisions have been made. As it relates to a curfew, we will continue as we do with every event to evaluate the use of a curfew as a tool.
Possibility of people's cars being searched when they either come into Washington, D.C. or come into any of the areas near the perimeter.
Let me ask the Secret Service agent, if Agent Miller and Chief Conte.
Thank you. Thank you, Mayor. To amplify the mayor's response on the closures, as you saw on the graphic there, there are written street closures published across all of the various law enforcement and public safety partners. So whether it's the Secret Service's social media sites, the District of Columbia, the Metropolitan Police Departments. We are working on publishing a graphic, as we typically do. I would just caution everyone that we are currently on, I think, version 11, given all the changes dictated by the events of the 6th. And there are still negotiations, as the mayor indicated, with Richmond as to when the bridges across the rivers will be closed, when they will be reopened, which specific bridges those will be. As far as your question about cars and other traffic, so trucks making deliveries to hotels or businesses, any vehicle, once the secure perimeter is in place, that enters one of the designated checkpoints will be searched for explosives, weapons, and other prohibited items. So there will be a joint team from the Metropolitan Police Department, the Secret Service's Technical Security Division, and depending on resource constraints, Department of Defense or National Guard, explosive ordnance specialists. We are looking for weapons, threats, or explosives. Outside of that, the vehicle is safe to enter once it's been cleared and swept and has a legitimate purpose inside the zone.
What about outside the zone? Can people expect those type of searches outside, just entering the city? And then can I also ask you about use of force? I know the National Guard is not here, but can you tell us when use of force would be acceptable by any of these National Guard troops who we see who are now armed?
Okay, that's a two-part question. So
Thank you. Part one,
outside of the secure zone, vehicles, residents, guests will be able to enter and transit the district as normal. It's only when you are attempting to enter what we call the green line or the red line. The green line is essentially the soft perimeter leading up to the red line where there are absolute searches coming in. So outside of that, vehicles and deliveries will continue as normal. Your second question, as far as the rules of engagement, the National Guard Bureau was publishing rules of engagement and printing rules of engagement cards for each of its soldiers deployed on this exercise. My understanding is that those rules of engagement or the use of force policy would comply with the agency to which they were assigned. So I know, for instance, that there is a detail of National Guard Bureau personnel up at the United States Capitol. They are complying with and will comport with the United States Capitol Police's use of force model. Most of the use of force models throughout the federal and local law enforcement community are very, very similar. There's not much daylight between them. There are some specific exceptions, but you can probably find those through the U.S. Capitol Police or the National Guard Bureau. Unless, Chief Conte, do you know the specifics for your personnel?
Yeah. Hey, Mark. With respect to the National Guard, specifically, as Matt mentioned, those policies pretty much follow the same framework as the host agency. You know, obviously, in defense of one's life or another. I think specifically with the DC National Guard for MPD's traffic posts, those persons that are deployed, their primary mission is to focus on traffic management, and that's a different mission from what's going on at the U.S. Capitol Police. So I think that's a distinction to make there. The other thing, too, with respect to your question about the vehicles being searched outside of the perimeter, if we have information, and as you know from the previous demonstrations that we've had here in our city, we have had armed individuals to come to our city. And there were firearms recovered in some instances. There were explosives recovered in another instance, Molotov cocktails from a vehicle. So if there's a need, obviously within the framework of the Constitution, to stop a vehicle for some type of check for weapons or something like that, we certainly will be deploying that measure as well.
Good afternoon. I'm James Wright with the Washington Informer newspaper. I have a question for Acting Chief Conte and Mr. Wiedefel.
Yes, Chief. Go ahead, James.
Okay. Chief Conte, we want to make sure that we have this right. MPD, for lack of a better term, all hands on deck. MPD will be all hands on deck for the inauguration zone. But what about the rest of the city? Will the rest of the city be covered, and will they be covered competently, even though you have many officers in the inauguration zone?
Thank you for the question. It's a great question, and I'll answer that very specifically. It's not just all hands on deck for the zone. It's all hands on deck for our entire agency, because our entire agency has responsibility for the entire city. With that being said, the influx of federal resources that you see into our city certainly allows for MPD to be agile, to be very nimble in terms of our response posture to any threats that may occur in any of our communities. We will have assets pre-stationed throughout different communities ready to respond, and a contingency of federal support if need be to respond to any threats that may present themselves. I'm sorry.
No. This is for Mr. Wiedefel. Okay. Mr. Wiedefel, many people in the community on social media, when they saw this plan of closing so many stations, they were very alarmed. Not so much that they're closing it within the inauguration zone, but the fact is that many people travel through that area to get to their jobs and obligations, and many of those people are low-income and working-class people, and they can't afford to telework in terms of getting to their jobs. When this plan came through, did that come to you as a consideration?
Of course it did. That was one of our largest concerns, was how do we continue to serve our customer base? We argued for, in effect, to be able to run the trains through the zone so that people would get to the other side without having to basically get off the train and get another means to get there. So that was a huge concern of ours. But as I said earlier, it is something that we don't welcome, but it is something that we all need to do to keep everyone safe.
Thank you. Claire Heim, CBS News. My first question is there any indication that extremist groups like the Proud Boys or the Boogaloos are planning on attending the inauguration next week or showing up?
Special Agent.
Thanks, Mayor. I would defer a specific answer to the FBI. I know that they are actively investigating and talking with a number of extremist groups, searching the internet, social media, for any indication they can get. And they are very, very careful to delineate between credible, specific, direct intelligence and information. So I'm not entirely certain, and I'm not entirely competent to answer that question. It is better addressed to the FBI. But as Director Ray has mentioned, there's a great deal of very concerning chatter, and it's what you don't know that we are preparing for. So I don't know if anyone has raised their hand to say, we are coming, we will be there, but we are preparing as if they are.
Let me just add that our team, led by Director Rodriguez and MPD, are having a daily download with the FBI to follow up on Special Agent's comment.
Thank you. Just my second question. People say the city kind of looks like a military takeover. There's armed troops, roadblocks, even just around the corner from where we are right now. What message, Mayor, are you sending?
I want to be very clear about this. As a person born and raised in this city, I have spent many days, I have spent a lot of time in and around our national monumental core. At these iconic structures, at the Capitol building, where there was an attempted coup. These things are so important, not just to America, but to the 712,000 people who call DC home. We traverse these roads and parks each and every day. The National Park is a park, and it is used not just for First Amendment demonstration, but for people to walk around the park, to get exercise, to play games, you name it. So we don't take any of the measures that we have taken lightly. Let me say something about your comment about a takeover. I have to remind DC residents that I asked the federal government to devise a deployment plan that would protect federal assets in the District of Columbia. And that is what has been done under the leadership of the United States Secret Service and the various agencies that have been mentioned. That is important, as you heard Chief Conte say, because our officers can also focus on keeping DC safe from any aspects of crime, including from these extremist groups that have attacked our Capitol.
Hi, Mayor, everyone up here. Thank you. Stephanie Ramirez with Fox 5 DC. Question for you is specifically to this weekend, Saturday and Sunday. Is the
is there any more information regarding what is expected? And when it comes to the permitted event, what happens if more than 100 people show? And what happens if people start to gather in places that are outside of the perimeter that has been established?
Okay, let me first, and thank you for asking that question, Stephanie, because part of my reasoning in requesting that this NSSE, this National Special Security event be advanced, the timeline for it be advanced, is because the inauguration is not the only target or activity that's out there being discussed. There are other events that lead up to that. And we thought it was very important that the proven and effective framework that the U.S. Secret Service sets up for this national security events would also be helpful in the lead up to the inauguration. I'm going to ask Chief Conte to talk about those threats and perhaps Park Service or Park Police talk about the First Amendment events.
Yeah, so, you know, when these threats come in, as I think Agent Miller mentioned, you know, there's a lot of chatter that's out there, obviously on the internet. We have a daily download with the FBI. We brief the mayor daily just on the information that's out there. And I can assure the residents of the District of Columbia that the Metropolitan Police Department and our federal partners are in a posture to respond to the information that's out there thus far that we've heard. And I think that's been, it's been, you know, it's been on all the news channels. We're hearing it, so we're certainly in a posture to respond.
Thank you, Mayor. Yes, in terms of this weekend, you will start to see, now that the fencing has gone up, as the Secret Service starts to activate some of those perimeters, we will fully support that. Access will become more and more restricted within the National Mall and within the areas that we have inside those boundaries. We have worked with everyone, all of the permittees that had requested either special events or demonstrations from now through the inauguration to find another time, find another location for their activity. For those two events that we have, they are groups that are very, my understanding is groups that are in DC quite a bit, have expressed First Amendment activities quite frequently throughout the district, and we've had a chance to talk to them and be able to make sure that they're able to scale their First Amendment demonstrations to the size that we have available. So we also thank them for working with us on this.
And Mayor Bowser, do you anticipate the area being able to go back to normal immediately after the NSSE period has ended or is expected to end?
I think that we're going to go back to a new normal, Stephanie. And I think that our entire country has to deal with how our intelligence apparatus, security apparatus at every level deal with a very real and present threat to our nation. We saw white extremists storm the Capitol building who were trained and organized and seemingly with the intent to capture the Vice President of the United States and perhaps harm other lawmakers. So we all have to think about a new posture. We certainly have to think about a new posture in the city. So while we are focused on January the 20th, we're also focused on January the 21st and every day thereafter in the nation's capital.
Mayor.
Yes.
Hi. Thank you, and to everyone on the stage as well. Kenneth Moten with ABC News. I just want to follow up on that last question because I wanted to drill down on that. Is that, do you expect many of the security measures we see now to last well after the president-elect takes office to continue providing that protection and helping the Secret Service provide that protection to President Biden, to Vice President Kamala Harris?
We do not expect to have visiting National Guard throughout the city for weeks to come. No, we don't expect that. But I do think that we have to replace that sense of security in other ways. So we certainly, from the district's perspective, will be thinking about that. Where actually also thinking about how our partnership with the federal government has to change so that we can have that increased sense of security. I won't bore you with the kind of the details of how we're budgeted to support our special security because we're the nation's capital, but those issues have to be dealt with. We also have to be dealt with the complicating factor of not being a state in that the mayor of the District of Columbia does not command the D.C. National Guard. We know that that's a complicating factor. So there are many things that we as a city will have to reset in terms of our posture in policing and in all of our homeland agencies that support First Amendment demonstrations. What will that reset look like?
And Mayor, you touched on it, but I want to ask one more time, since the world is seeing your city, the nation's capital, look more like a fortress, look more like a military base. You touched on it there, but I still have to ask you, what goes through you when you see your city looking the way it does now? Is there a disappointment? Is there a realization that this is the reality that we're in?
I'm sad about it. I have to tell you that it looks that way. I'm committed to making sure that we get our city back. Our visitors, our residents, our workers will be able to get through the city with ease. But I also know that we have a special responsibility, that there is a peaceful transition of power in our country. We're proud in Washington to host the federal government, and we want to make sure that event is peaceful.
Thank you, Mayor.
Hi, Amanda with the Washington City Paper. A follow on that. Mayor, do you think the fence around the Capitol should stay, or do you think that should be the first to go after all of this?
Amanda, I generally don't like fences, as you know, but I also see why it's important, especially now. It's important for a couple of reasons. First of all, those fences allow these police professionals to be able to deploy the human resource that they have, the officers, in a more efficient way. In other times, we were more concerned about interactions between police and people, and that fence is an additional barrier to reduce some of those interactions. So I think we are concerned about any fencing that's up in the District of Columbia would move. It is a temporary fence. It's not a permanent fence. You see how quickly goes up. It can just as quickly come down. But we want to make sure that there's not only a real replacement for what it provides, but the sense of safety that everybody in and around those facilities has is important. So we haven't fully developed a recommendation to our federal partners about when and how it comes down.
Thank you. And my last question is, what are the estimated costs for all of this, given the heightened security? I mean, I know the last I heard the district requested, was it $45 million to Congress? Do you have any?
For the inauguration?
That's correct.
Okay. I'm going to ask Chris Rodriguez to come up, who is the director of the district's Homeland Security Agency. He's also going to talk to you about a very specific process that we put in place to protect the district and make sure that we had a seamless process for federal assistance. Director Rodriguez?
Thank you, Mayor, and thank you for the question, Amanda. The district over a year ago, as we were beginning preparations for the inauguration, reached out to all our public safety and support agencies to estimate our costs for the inauguration, and we estimated those costs at $34.9 million. That was our request to Congress for the district's inauguration fund. It's important to note that part of our request was also looking at deficits that we had run in our Emergency Planning and Security Fund, which is annually appropriated by Congress, because of the heightened number of First Amendment demonstrations we've seen throughout the year. So as we were planning for this specific inauguration, after the First Amendment demonstrations that we saw over the summer, we changed that number to, as you mentioned, $44.9 million, or roughly $45 million. That additional $10 million was not approved, and it still has not been approved at this time. In terms of the mayor mentioned some of the federal assistance that we're putting in place. Mayor Bowser requested of FEMA a pre-disaster emergency declaration for the inauguration last week. That was approved on Monday. And as Administrator Tierney mentioned, through the district's Emergency Operations Center, we've been able to coordinate all of our resource requests, not only for public safety, but also for health and medical, for public works, to make sure that they had all the assets, federal assets that they needed to support the entire inauguration process. So that's being run out of our EOC, and we have FEMA there now helping us with those coordination and requests.
Thank you.
These are the last two questions.
Thank you.
Hi, Sarah Payne from Capital Community News. There have been reports of National Guard members asking residents in neighborhoods surrounding the Capitol to show identification before they can return home. What are the boundaries in which residents will need to do this?
Thank you, Chief Conte.
Yeah, so thank you for the question. We want to make sure that residents are able to get access to their homes. So in the event that in the efforts to ensure security around the Capitol, that also bumped out to some of the neighborhoods, and there's a fence line there. If residents were to show their ID, again, that the National Guard members that are there are primarily there for traffic control, they should be able to gain access to that area and should not incur any issues. If they do, please feel free to reach out to the Metropolitan Police Department. We'll coordinate with our Secret Service partners as well to resolve any issues that members in the community may be having.
Okay, and then what steps are being taken to secure those residential areas and neighborhoods surrounding that Capitol perimeter area?
So we have strategically placed resources, again, Metropolitan Police Department resources in different areas around the Capitol footprint to ensure, again, a sense of safety and security for our residents. The federal resources are here, and we're very appreciative of that. That relieves us of the responsibility of having to take care of federal buildings in the downtown footprint. So we have officers that are deployed to the communities to ensure safety and security.
Thank you. We're done. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you.